Good morning, everyone, and welcome back, and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in the Scottish Parliament's 5th session. I'd like to ask everyone in the room to ensure that the mobile phones are switched to silent. Of course, we can use them for social media, but please don't take calls, photographs or film proceedings if you're ever so inclined. The first item on today's agenda is subordinate legislation. This is consideration of an affirmative instrument. As usual, with an affirmative instrument, we will have an evidence-taking session with the Cabinet Secretary and our officials on the instrument. Once we've had all our questions answered, we'll have a formal debate on the motion. The instrument before us today is the Smoking Prohibition Children and Motor Vehicles Scotland Act 2016 Fixed Penalty Notices Regulations 2016 Draft. That is what you call a mouthful. We welcome to the committee Shona Robinson, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, Fraser Morris, Team Leader Health Improvement Tobacco Control Policy, and Joanne Irvine, Principal Legal Officer, Scottish Government. Welcome. I would invite a brief opening statement from the Cabinet Secretary.
Well, thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for the invitation to give evidence to the committee on the draft Smoking Prohibition Children and Motor Vehicles Scotland Act 2016 Fixed Penalty Notices Regulations 2016. The approval of these regulations will allow for the full implementation in December. Following that, anyone caught smoking in a car with someone under 18 could face prosecution and a fine of up to £1,000 or pay a fixed penalty of £100 to the local authority. The Act was passed by unanimous vote, in part because it builds on and mirrors the successful 2006 smoking ban in enclosed public places. And as was the case in 2005, we again require secondary legislation to set out two practical details. These are that, firstly, the number of days within which a fixed penalty notice must be issued should be 21 days to give police and council sufficient time to coordinate. And secondly, local authorities must keep accounts and use any revenue raised through penalties to improve local amenities. These details have been agreed with police and councils who will be enforcing the law. Evidence on the harmful effects of secondhand smoke is clear, and children are especially vulnerable. This government's commitment to protecting children from the impact of smoke led us in 2014 to announce the target of reducing the proportion of young people exposed in the home from 11% to 6% by 2020, potentially protecting 50,000 children. And last month's Scottish Health Survey revealed that we'd met this target 5 years early. However, smoking prevalence remains higher in Scotland than elsewhere in the UK. The ban on smoking in public places, the display ban, and our commitment to a tobacco-free generation all contribute to the culture and behavioural change needed to improve public health. The ban on smoking in cars with children will do likewise.
Thank you very much, Convener. Do we have Cabinet Secretary? Do we have any questions, Richard?
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. When we brought in the no smoking ban in pubs and clubs, everyone thought it wouldn't work, but it has. Mm-hmm. In the last session, I supported Jim Hume and his members' bill to bring in non-smoking in cars, even though I am a smoker. But I took the decision a number of years ago, because of having grandchildren, that I would no longer smoke in my car. And I find that my car smells better. My grandkids enjoy being in the car better. But the point is, many people who would be against this have to know when it's coming in, what we're going to be doing. So my question is, what steps are we taking to advertise this law? When I think the English law came in, there was quite heavy advertising on the television. Could I ask what steps we're taking to inform the public in order to ensure that people realise that they no longer should smoke in their car?
Mm-hmm. Well, there is going to be a public awareness campaign that's going to run ahead of the legislation coming in to force, and it will involve various media, including TV, radio, social media, and website information. So I think you make an important point. I mean, the whole rationale here, I think, is behavioural change. So, you know, as we've seen with, I suppose, seatbelt and mobile phones using legislation, it's designed to safeguard good behaviour and change behaviour. So this is very much in that same sphere. So it is important, though, that people know the information, and as I said earlier, there will be a full public awareness campaign to make sure that everyone knows that the law is changing.
Thank you.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just wonder what the view of Police Scotland is in terms of how they intend to police this, particularly in the sort of introductory months, whether that's going to be spot checks or pulling cars over, use of cameras, that kind of thing.
Well, of course, they've been fully involved in the discussions and implementation, which is why, of course, there has been the time taken to get the enforcement issues in place. As I understand, I'll ask officials to say a little bit more. I think initially there's intention to have a softly approach, so that you know people, while the law is changing, as we've done, I think in previous cases, there's a kind of soft landing, and people may be kind of warned and so on and so forth. Do you want to say a little bit more about that?
Yes, we've had quite intensive negotiations with the police, just looking at what's happened in England and Wales, where they've had this for a year, and Police Scotland are going to be doing the same. So as Cabinet Secretary says, a light touch at first, just more of an education than a criminalisation. After all, if there were no fines issued for bad, you know, it would mean that people were adhering to the principle, and it is the culture change we're looking for, not the criminalisation. So initially it'll mean just be education.
Can I just pick up on the point that you made there, Mr. Morris, about similar legislation already being in place in England? And have we had any feedback from our colleagues south of the border about how efficient this has been in terms of reducing smoking in cars, how the public have taken to it, and how effective it's been?
We have in health surveys. We've collected data even in Scotland, even since the ban came in England. We've noticed in Scotland there's been a reduction in the reporting here of people of children saying that they're being exposed to smoke in cars. And while there's no official stats yet from England on actual car use, the stats on the health survey would suggest that it's definitely having an effect, and even here as well.
Could I ask how many people you would expect to have been caught by the offence in, say, the first year?
When the Act was going forward, we thought as many as 100, but that's just a ballpark figure. In England and Wales, the number of prosecutions has only, in a year, been only about 6 or 7, but the reduction in incidents of people smoking in cars shows that the legislation there has worked as a deterrent rather than something that we count prosecutions on. So if there were none, that would be really good. And as I say, for the first 6 months or so, we don't think the police will be doing anything too draconian, unless it's something particularly a bad offender.
If I can just pick up there, you were talking about the police, but obviously councils have a role in enforcing this. Is there going to be a similar softly approach from councils?
Very much so. The smoking ban also has police and council officials enforcing that, but in fact it's almost completely the council officers who enforce that. With this one, both have the powers, but it will almost wholly be the police who enforce this one. They, after all, have the power to stop a car. Local authorities only have the power to enter a car, which is a race stop. So they can do roadside campaigns along with the police, perhaps. But again, they're of the same mind that this is about an education and not a criminalisation.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you very much. We now move on to agenda item 2. Subordinate legislation, which is the formal debate on the affirmative instrument that we've just taken evidence on. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to move the motion?
Formally.
Okay. And any members wish to contribute to any debating points? Richard.
As I've already said, I think it's a very worthwhile law and something which we all should support, and that includes smokers. and I believe that it will be a better health situation for children in cars, and I certainly support this item.
Alison?
I'd just like to add my support too. As was mentioned in opening remarks, smoking prevalence remains higher in Scotland, and I think if children grow up in an environment where it's not normalised, you know, that will enable us to proceed on a healthier footing in the future. Thank you.
Yeah, Alec.
Thank you, Convener. I think that the fact that this Act's achieved cross-party unanimous support in Parliament speaks volumes, and I think it would be certainly remiss of myself not to pay tribute to my predecessor, Jim Hume, both my party colleague, but also the former Liberal Democrat health spokesperson who brought this forward.
Anyone else? Okay, I think we would all agree with that and commend Mr. Hume for his initiative. I think there's widespread support for this move across the Parliament. Okay, Cabinet Secretary, would you like to sum up and respond to any of the issues that have been raised?
I just agree. I think it's all part of the as Alison Johnson said, denormalising smoking and normalising not smoking and children not being exposed to smoke. I think that's a critical point. And also, finally, just to also pay tribute to Jim Hume, I think it is a good example of cross-party working where someone comes forward with a good idea and it seemed to be so, and that we were... found it a very good and worthwhile experience in working with Jim Hume to get the legislation to the point that it is now. So.
Okay, thank you very much. The question is now that the motion S5M01593 be approved. Are we all agreed? That's agreed. Thank you very much. Can I thank the officials for attending today? The Cabinet Secretary is, of course, staying with us for the next item of business, and we'll suspend briefly for the next set of officials to come in. The third item on the agenda today is an evidence session on health and social care integration budgets. I would like to welcome to the committee Shona Robinson, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, Jeff Huggins, Director of Health and Social Care Integration, and Christine McLaughlin, Director of Health Finance, Scottish Government. Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement, please?
Thanks, Convener. Certainly welcome the committee's ongoing interest in the integration of health and social care and the opportunity to discuss budgets in more detail. As you know, the number of older people in Scotland is increasing, and by 2037, those aged 75 or over is projected to increase by 360,000. That people are living longer is, of course, something to be celebrated, but it does present real challenges for us in how we design and deliver health and social care services. As the population ages, the demand on the health service in particular grows, and the nature, complexity and acuity of that demand grows as well. These changes mean that delivering even the current levels of service in the same way as been done in the past is not sustainable. Radical service redesign, including the integration of health and social care, is required to meet these challenges. Our legislation to integrate health and social care is one of the most ambitious programmes of work this government has ever undertaken, and all health and social care partnerships are now fully operational. And whilst these are in many ways still early days, these new arrangements are already having an impact on our health and social care services. One of the most significant changes which have occurred as a result of integration is regards budgets. integration authorities are now responsible for managing more than £8 billion of resources that NHS boards and local authorities previously managed separately. Planning, designing and commissioning services in an integrated way from a single budget allows partnerships to take a more joined-up approach, more easily shifting resources to target preventative activity. And as with any programme of public service reform, we expect efficiencies to be made, which can be reinvested in services. However, integration is more than about budget. It's about putting people at the centre of the care that they need. We're supporting these changes through significant additional funding. We've already provided a further £250 million from the NHS to health and social care partnerships to protect and expand social care services and deliver our shared priorities. This is the first part of fulfilling the commitment from our programme for government to invest £1.3 billion over the life of the Parliament from the NHS to integrated partnerships to build up social care capacity. Whilst the new budget arrangements under integration are key to delivering change, and I welcome the opportunity to discuss this with the committee today, it is important to remember that at its core, integration is not just about budget, it is about putting people at the centre of the care that they need.
Thank you very much for that. You said that when you came into post that you would eradicate delayed discharge. Social care is central to that. Have you succeeded or failed?
Well, it's work in progress. I'll admit that it's tough. It's very difficult to change something that has essentially been part of the system for a long time. However, what I would say is I am absolutely optimistic and as committed as I was previously to eradicating it. We need to eradicate it. One of the biggest changes has been the move to the 3-day discharge standard. So instead of the assumption that people will be delayed in the system being part of the, if you remember, the 6-week, then the 4-week target. So there was already an assumption of delay being built in to the system. The 3-day standard has done away with that thinking, and it gets people immediately thinking about the discharge of the person rather than a delay in their care being put together. And if you look at what Glasgow have done around that, they have, working to the 3-day standard, have managed to dramatically reduce the number of delays that they have in their system. Other partnerships have been slower to do that, and we, through Jeff and his team, have been working very closely with those partnerships that need to deliver the same performance. If all partnerships were delivering the performance of the top 25%, we would half the number of delays straight away. Now, I want all partnerships to be working to the best. There's no reason why they can't deliver that same performance, but we need to work with them to overcome any hurdles in them doing that, to deliver best practice, to do the things that we know work. And if we get all of that right, then we will eradicate delay out of the system. Now, having said that, there are complexities around Code 9s, and we're working through the adults with incapacity issue, because you know that is difficult to resolve, because you've got court proceedings, which means that people are stuck in hospital, which is no fault of either the health system or the social care system, and that accounts for about a third, I think, of all delays. So there are those complexities as well, but you know, I am absolutely determined to work through all of that to get us to a position where delay is no longer an acceptable part of our system.
In relation to that, do you think the social care system as it stands is fit for purpose?
I think it needs reformed, and COSLA and local authorities are up for reforming that. That has to be done in partnership. I think we need to look at different ways of delivering social care. I'm very keen on some of the models we've seen, which are essentially, if you boil it down, about empowering frontline staff. If you look at, we've talked before, I think, about the Boertzorg model from the Netherlands, which can be applied to social care or nursing. And it has, at its core, the empowerment of frontline staff working with patients or clients, servants, users, whatever the terminology, to be able to manage better the people under their care, without the need to constantly report back to structures and bureaucracy. Now, we're testing that out here in Scotland, and I do think ideas like that are the way forward for not just social care, but potentially nursing and community health as well. I think it shows that staff get a lot more pleasure and fulfilment in their job, but also more importantly, those receiving the services get a better service, and indeed most often it's more efficient too.
We'll come on to some of those issues as we go into our discussion, and I'll invite some other members to come in at this stage. Alex.
Thank you, Convener. One of the key responsibilities of the IJBs, particularly given the weight of the money they now control, is the delivery of the eradication of health inequalities. One of the biggest ones is alcohol and drugs misuse, and we heard from Rob McCulloch-Graham, who is the chair of the IJB in Lothian, that budget for ADP funding will reduce by 1.3 million across Lothian. That's part of the 20% cut that was delivered to ADP budgets in the last financial settlement. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary can tell me whether you think that the IJBs have the tools they need to deliver these reductions in health inequalities, and in particular what we're going to do about drug and alcohol funding?
Well, I think the first thing to say is that actually the delivery of the outcomes that we've asked partnerships to deliver in terms of the number of brief interventions and the delivery of services, they are delivering that and more so. And actually some partnerships are going well beyond what they've been asked to deliver in terms of targets. We asked as part of the financial settlement for boards to deliver resources to ensure the continuation of levels of funding previously. I'm aware some have, others have not. Now, we're obviously monitoring that, and Christine is in discussion with boards around that. We've also said we want to review generally the makeup and delivery and the funding of ADPs, I think, to make sure that we are getting the right structures, the right focus, the right targets, and resources will be part of that going forward. So I'm aware of some of the localities expressing some concern, others less so. And Christine might want to say a little bit more about some of the detailed discussions that you've had with partnerships.
Yeah, I think we've been keen to look at the service delivery rather than just focusing on the financial position, and asking partnerships to look at the extent to which they felt they could provide the services that they needed to in more innovative, more efficient ways. And I think that's what we're seeing happening. I think where it falls down is if somebody just looks at it as a cut to the amount of money that you have and still providing the same, trying to look at providing the same services without changing. And I think some of the challenge has been the time that it needs to allow partnerships to look at different models with reductions in funding. So in some instances, what we've seen is boards looking to maintain the levels of funding, but at the same time giving a time frame within which they expect to see changes happen with service delivery. I think that's where it's working well. So we'll be looking at that very closely as part of the budget setting process for next year, to understand what can actually what types of models partnerships have been looking at putting in place. But the underlying position that was said with boards is that funding should be maintained within this financial year, that we expect to see efficiencies develop through the year.
To add to that, because I think when Rob gave evidence as part of his answer, he also talked about his ability to use resource flexibly across the piece to secure the outcomes. And that was one of the founding principles of integration, that instead of handing the money out in small bundles and expecting it to be used in the way that was directed nationally, that the expectation nationally was that we would achieve the outcomes, that we'd be able to evidence those through the indicators over time, and that in that context that we would expect people like Rob and his colleagues, chief officers across the country, not just to be thinking about how this money supports drug and alcohol outcomes, but be thinking across the piece about how the overall service supports drug and alcohol outcomes. So I think we're in a slightly different space, and if we continue to simply to follow each pound based on how it was historically spent and expected to be spent in the same way, then we probably won't take the benefit from integration that we're looking for.
Okay, thank you for that. And I think that point about outcomes is well made. I'm sure everybody around this table agrees that, you know, that's the priority. It doesn't really matter what resource we put behind it as long as those outcomes are delivered. However, I don't think we'll see the actual payoff or the reaction to that reduction in funding until further down the track, as we see outcomes drop off as a result of the 1.3 million lost to ADP services in Lothian. My anxiety about the terminology here is that we keep using the word efficiencies, and I think everybody accepts that we need to make efficiencies, but when you talk about efficiencies, to my mind, that means maybe a cut of 2 or 3 or 4%, and that's, you know, we've seen that year on year. But when you're talking about 20% of funding, that's a cut. That's not an efficiency. That is an absolute slash to the budget. And I know, having spoken to people who work in the ADP workforce, that they are up in arms about this. It's a real anxiety. They won't be able to deliver these outcomes, regardless of how well-intentioned that proposal is. And I'm not sure that we're ever going to be able to achieve those outcomes without a sufficient degree of funding.
Well, I think that's why we need to interrogate that more closely about whether or not outcomes can be achieved. Clearly, some partnerships are saying they can, and in fact, some have maintained the level of funding. So it is a mixed picture. I think where we need to spend more time will be with those partnerships that say they can't, and we need to understand why that is and why others can. As I said, some are actually in, at the moment, over, like, delivering more than they've been asked to deliver, which is not a bad thing. We need to get the targets right. And, of course, there's the more general review of targets about what we measure and why. And that applies as much to alcohol and drugs as any other area. And, you know, we need to make sure that, as Jeff's point was, if we stick rigidly to, you know, this is funding for this, this, this and this, and then nothing will change, which is why we've tried to remove some of the restrictions on what can be spent on what, to allow partnerships to be more flexible in where they spend their money to get the outcomes. And if we focus on that and achieving the outcomes, then hopefully we can work through some of these issues. But we will be keeping a very close eye on those partnerships that are telling us that they have problems. And obviously the one you've cited is one in particular.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to ask you a bit of a wider question, if you like, about budget setting timelines. One of the issues that has been raised by IJBs through the interrogation of this committee consistently, whether it be orally or in written answers, is about the sort of misalignment, if you like, of timelines of budget setting, which then has an impact on IJBs setting their budgets. Councils set the budgets at a different time of year to the NHS, and subsequently then that has a knock-on effect. Is there any scope for looking at timings of setting budgets? And if so, what sort of work is the Scottish Government looking at doing on this?
I think you raise an important issue. There is quite a challenge. Obviously, local authorities have a statutory obligation to set their budget before the 1st of April, whereas some health boards set theirs in the first quarter of the new year. And obviously with the challenge of the spending review constraints as well, that played into quite a difficult situation. What we're doing is working with health boards and local authority directors of finance and integration authority chief finance officers to get pull together guidance on good practice for budget setting, so that the processes will be better aligned for 2017-18. I also, it's important to bear in mind that the statutory guidance stipulates that budget setting for year two onwards should be a process based on negotiation about the level of funding, performance associated risks, rather than a roll forward of individual service budgets used for initial allocations. It comes back to the point Jeff was making earlier on, that if all that happens is that there's the same
things or the same resources are spent on the same things, just in an integrated fashion, and nothing changes. And I think that's the point about year two onwards, that the expectation is quite a different process based on negotiation and looking at change. So I think it's not unexpected that year one was going to be challenging in that respect, but we will expect to see more of that in year two onwards.
I think it's an area that you should expect to see a lot of improvement on next year. We have been working quite closely. I think we knew that the first year was going to be one of transition. We had made a decision with the NHS to allow an extended period for the financial plans, which took them into June of this year, and that was to recognise the need to be working with IGB. So from that very start, you had local authorities setting their budgets by normally mid-March, and we hadn't. Normally we would require NHS boards to have their delivery plans and their financial plans signed off by 31st of March as well. So we had allowed that period of time, but that did mean, obviously, for IGBs, we were starting the year without a firm plan in place. Although I think it's probably fair to say that there was a level of strategic financial plans in place, but they didn't have the bottom-up detail that you'd like to see in your budgets. So there's a lot of work going on just now. There are boards that are working to a December position to have indicative budgets in place for IGBs. So I think between December and January, I would expect to see much greater clarity about budgets for next year. But what we're also definitely seeing on the ground is much greater involvement of chief officers, chief finance officers, in that planning process. And I think some of the good examples are where you've actually got local government, NHS and IGBs working collectively as part of that, influencing the level of budgets for IGBs. Whereas I think in year one, it was very much handing a budget over to the IGB, much greater engagement all the way through. I mean, that being said, I think we need to recognise that where boards are starting the year without a balanced position, and we've got three boards this year, clearly the IGB is part of the solution as well, and how they look to recover that. So I think I would probably want to manage an expectation that there will still be an element of decisions that will be taken in some cases after the financial year into next year, but that's part of, I think, what would be the IGB influencing the position rather than waiting to see what their budget is going to be.
Thank you for that. Some reassurance there that there is work being done behind the scenes, mm-hmm. In terms of trying to have a budget that is more aligned. Are there specifically plans for having budgets at the same time? Because the budgets seem to have been off kilter.
So the local authorities work to mid-March, mm-hmm. to set their budgets. The NHS does work to 31st of March. I don't envisage that we would have that three-month extension again for next year. So all things being equal, we would expect it to be at the same time. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've spoken to a couple of the NHS directors of finance just this week to check, and they are saying to me that they expect to give high-level budgetary figures that are negotiated with the IGBs round about January. December-January, so I think that's a much greater improved position, probably bringing the process back by about 3 or 4 months. So in summary, yes, I think you should see alignment between the two.
Thank you.
Miles?
Thank you, Convener. A lot of the evidence which the committee's looked at around this has shown the difficulties in trying to get resources out of the acute setting and into the community. And so as the policy goes forward, how do you see a successful outcome looking in terms of the share of budgets between community and also in institutional care? And secondly, you touched upon the overspends. How do you think that's going to be impacting in terms of taking this policy forward within health boards?
I mean, I think it is difficult to, and it always has been, to release resources from the acute setting. That is no different, I think, under the world of integration, from the hospital set aside budgets. However, if you look at some of the examples
I know that one of the examples used, where integration authorities were asked to bring forward specific examples of their plans. Of course, was Edinburgh City's closure of Liberton Hospital and the reprovision of services within the community. I think where the opportunity lies is for through the development of alternative services, for that balance to be struck in a better way. But of course, it's a chicken and egg situation. The services have to be developed in order to reduce pressure for then the acute service to be able to release that resource. So getting that into the right order is not easy, and I don't think anyone ever said it would be. The Integrated Care Fund was, which is £300 million over 3 years, was put in place to help the transition period, if you like, so that services could be built up, which could relieve pressure and potentially release resources from the acute sector. Now, there's lots of good examples around the country of it being used to good effect, and we would expect to see more of that and the use of some of those resources. Jeff?
Thank you. Maybe one of the interesting examples that we're in the process of seeing coming into this winter is the different approach that the Ayrshires are taking to winter. So the Ayrshires are going into year two of integration. They launched on the 1st of April 2015. And whereas in previous years, part of the planning process for winter would have been to make provision for additional wards and additional beds within the hospital, so that as demand went up, they would then open those. Our experience has been that those are very difficult to close. And you know, we experienced the challenge of still having winter wards open in June, July, and August, and that, you know, that's a significant financial burden, and also means that people are in hospital who otherwise might be elsewhere. So the plans that they've brought forward, based on the experience that they were able to work through during last winter, largely are built around the addition of extra community capacity to absorb the further demand as they go into winter. Now, they're being careful about this, so they're building also in a contingency should they require additional hospital capacity, that it is still available for them. But their first line of planning is that they will build the community service. And so that's not the closure of a hospital, it's not the closure of a ward, but it's saying instead of doing what we used to do, we will now find a different solution. So we're beginning to see that appear across the country, particularly as partnerships mature into using the integrated space differently. And I think that's really quite exciting.
Overspend. So we're seeing, for instance, I think about NHS 5, that's one of the boards that's working through a recovery plan. Their chief officer is working as part of that senior team in looking at what the options are. Because in a best situation, your recovery plan financially will be something that supports your operational plan. And what you see is the chief officer being round the table. And when I'm having discussions with that board about their plan, the chief officer is just feels like part of the team in working up what those plans are. So it's not something that gets given to the IGB as a target to deliver. They're actually looking at the plans and what they can contribute towards it. And I think that's a positive step they would like to see replicated across the country.
Thank you, Convener. I had the honour to be on the last health committee, and we looked at this bill, and basically what was put across was one of the reasons was to get rid of delayed discharge, but also was mentioned in that the preamble at the time was about £140 million worth of savings. I don't see those savings coming through now. Concern I have is that some joint boards are taking on more than we envisaged that they would do. It's becoming arms and legs. One council, I'll not name them, is now 9 months down the road of not setting a budget, and we're now going into 2017. So do you have any concerns about what some boards are taking on board? And I'll be another question in regards to that. And do you have any concerns about whether they will make these savings, which we intended would be reinvested in putting better care out there?
I think we want integrated authorities to be ambitious in what they're doing, but we want them to be clear about how they're going to achieve what they've set out to achieve, and for that to be realistic and to then be delivered. I mean, the efficiency savings are to be reinvested. What we would expect, whether that's the health boards or through the integration authorities, is to be ensuring that the resources that and the priorities and the resources aligned to those priorities deliver some of the changes that Jeff has just outlined. A very good example in Ayrshire about where resources are aligned to really begin to make the difference and begin to shift the balance of care. So I'm probably a bit more optimistic than that. I think we are seeing some really, really good examples of integration working as was intended. However, I think there are some who have got further to travel, and as is ever the case in this world, there will always be those who fire on ahead and reap the benefits very quickly, and those who need more support. Sometimes that's an issue of leadership locally. Sometimes there are other challenges that get in the way. Jeff and his team spend a lot of time, and as does Christine, working with individual partnerships that perhaps have more of those challenges. And that's why that's right and proper. Christine, do you want to?
So the I've gone back and have a look, and I was involved in the figures that were in the financial memorandum at the time. I think the principle in there was showing that we should expect a reduction in occupied bed days, whether that was through reduction in variations, as I mentioned earlier, delayed discharges, but that's what we expected to see. I think if you actually look at what's happening even just this year, in the first full year, the efficiency savings that IGB's required to make to balance their overall bottom line is in the region of about £225 million. Now that will be a combination of efficiencies, as you mentioned earlier. An efficiency can come in different forms, but part of that is the focus on delayed discharge. But more than that, I think it's the extent to which partnerships can achieve a reduction in variation that improves clinical outcomes, but also is more efficient, is where we're headed. The analysis that was in the financial memorandum was about indicative cost. It was on a cost per bed day. So we know that in order to make an actual saving, you need to take out costs, which is either areas like reducing nursing agency and bank costs, or ultimately taking out the equivalent of a ward that didn't feel like it was necessary, whether it's winter beds or along those lines. So I think partnerships are very focused on what translates into a cash releasing saving as much as a productivity saving as we go through. But if you just think about that target of £225 million for this financial year, it's already above that indicative figure that was in the financial memorandum. And that's an amount that's required in cash rather than productivity in this year. So I think what will be important is for us to be able to look at what it's meant in terms of reduction in occupied bed days that were felt to be areas where the service has been provided in the community rather than the acute setting. So I can't give you an absolute figure on that yet, because I think we need to get through this first year to see what that looks like. But if the partnerships achieve somewhere in the region of 3%, which is what they're targeting, then I think that gives us a good basis for delivering those efficiencies within IGBs.
I agree with Jeff Huggins. Ayrshire impressed me because they showed where their savings were coming and how they were. And maybe it's bean counters, I don't know. But can I move on, because other members have got questions? One concern I have is, again, the point of taking on too much. I was surprised this week when I contacted Social Work Department in regards to a house extension for a physically challenged young constituent, that now is under the JIBS, under the Joint Integration Board, which totally astounded me. Maybe it's the care in the community part that they're putting in, but I thought, you know, when I want to talk about getting an extension for somebody in their house at the cost of something like £25,000, I'm now getting referred to the Joint Integrated Board manager, which totally foxed me. You know, do you believe that those sort of things should be under joint integrated boards?
I can see the logic, given that, you know, housing adaptations are very quite often the barrier to someone remaining in at home and or being delayed in hospital because of adaptations pending or being delayed. So I can see why. The housing element, and remember there was a long discussion about the housing element, yeah, of integration, and a recognition that actually things like aids and adaptations are actually quite fundamental often to moving and ensuring someone can remain living in their own home or be returned home.
Yeah, maybe just to say something about a number of the housing examples which are out there. So the Highland Lead Agency at the moment is doing work around housing options, particularly to address some of the challenges of offering residential care in more rural and remote settings. So they're seeing housing as a key component of the work. You know, similarly, Murray, about 5 or 6 weeks ago, just began the process of creating 13 tenancies to replace a previous residential setting, which will offer a higher quality, broadly for people with challenges around capacity and dementia, but which will effectively offer closer to independent living for that group. In Fife, they've done an extensive piece of work to bring together all of the equipment and aids and adaptations work and bring together a series of different stores which sat between the social work department and the health department to get better value, but also faster access to things. And again, you know, looking at Ayrshire, in East Ayrshire, in Kilmarnock, the Lily Hill development, which they actually developed as part of a broader social housing development. So this wasn't a particular health and care, but was a health and care component to a housing redevelopment in the town centre, has built award-winning accommodation for people, particularly with learning disabilities, which it enables them to being more included in the community than they would have been before in individual tenancies or in residential. So we're seeing housing as being one of the areas where it was perhaps a bit further behind 2 or 3 years ago, but a lot of the options that are coming forward in that space.
So everything, just lastly, so everything that basically is keeping people in their home, care in the community, all that basically will come under a joint integrated board, and they have to, from the health and from the council, be funded for that.
So they have the mandatory list of things which they must bring into the integration area, and then beyond that, they can think within local circumstances as to what makes sense to add to it. And we're seeing housing developing quite quickly. We're seeing more areas also bring in children's social work services. Most children's health services are already integrated, so we're seeing that become part of the story as well, thinking again across the life course. And we're also seeing, you know, in a number of areas, criminal justice social work, and that's got the linkages both to mental health and addictions. So people are trying to find ways of bundling together and thinking across the needs of the individual rather than the needs of the individual services. And, you know, that's very progressive.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, convener. I'm actually really heartened to hear that housing is, you know, being viewed in that way. The longest delayed discharge case I've dealt with was it was a family person that had a stroke, couldn't return to his tenement flat, and we had quite a long wait. So I think it's heartening to hear that there's such good work happening, certainly in parts of the country. You mentioned the Highland model there briefly, and when we heard from Nick Kenton of NHS Highland a couple of weeks ago, he stated that what makes the lead agency model powerful is that operational budgets, management and governance are entirely integrated into one body. Now, Audit Scotland have noted potentially confusing lines of accountability around IGBs and a lack of clarity about who is ultimately responsible for quality of care. And I'd just be interested in your views about whether that lead agency model offers advantages and whether there's a feeling that perhaps the governance arrangements of IGBs are making autonomy difficult, particularly in terms of budget setting.
I think Highland will be a good way of interrogating that over time, because of course Highland covers both the lead agency and the IGB model in terms of the areas that they cover. So even within that one area, you're going to have lead agency for part, and then IGB for other parts of NHS Highland. So I think that will be an interesting contrast. I am probably less convinced that it's about the structure and whether or not the lead agency model offers up a better governance and accountability solutions than IGBs. I think leadership is the most important thing here, and rather than it necessarily being about the structure. And I think where we've seen the most progress being made is where local leadership is strong and the ideas are flowing, they're ambitious to change things, and we see some really, really, really good results out of that. I don't know, Jeff, would you?
Yeah. And I suppose Highland is quite an interesting example, reading forward from the housing discussion, because of course housing isn't part of the responsibility of the lead agency. Yeah. So, you know, certainly what we've seen over the last two or three years is greater engagement with the council in terms of the functions that still sit with the council as part of the process, because, you know, there you have a delegation of a function, so the council still retains a responsibility for the functions which are discharged by the health board. I think the challenge on this is that, you know, part of the intention of integration is to tie together a wider range of organisations and individuals to secure better outcomes for people. Mm-hmm. And finding simpler ways to do that to reduce complexity and reduce the degree to which people are involved probably doesn't take us there. Mm-hmm. So I think I would agree entirely with the Cabinet Secretary that we see those areas moving fastest and doing best where they show the greatest leadership. Mm-hmm. So it is ultimately about leadership, but also that interdependence that integration is intended to build.
Mm-hmm. If you look at the first 18 months or so of that lead agency model, there was actually a number of budgetary issues. So although it was in some ways simpler, there was a lack of understanding about the budget that was transferring from the local authority to the health board in particular. And it probably did take them about 18 months before they really fully understood the scope of services within that. So there were a different set of transitional issues which are now very much in the past, and it's working much better. So I think there is something about maybe accepting that first year of something that is so differently. This will have some degree of turbulence in the system. So I'm not sure that one isn't necessarily shown to be a smoother initial process in that first year.
Okay, thank you. If I might ask another question, Convener. I mean, obviously, we're faced with increasing demand on our services. We have an ageing population, an ageing growing population, and rising costs. So there are clear challenges here, but they're not all financial. Some of them are about a cultural change if we're really going to see this shift from, you know, acute to real community care. And I just wondered, in our earliest evidence sessions, we heard about a bit of risk aversion, that perhaps those in certain services weren't aware about the community offering, and Mr. Huggins, you were speaking there about the need to tie together a range of services. I just wonder what's going on behind the scenes there to make sure that professionals in all areas are aware of one another's work and the opportunities that there are in, you know, transferring people at an appropriate time back to a home setting or a different care setting.
I think one of the strengths of Glasgow is very much around the operational managers being empowered to make some of those operational decisions and to get on with change. And I think that has resulted in the ability of something's not working to do things differently and change things. And speaking to the managers and staff in Glasgow, they pinpointed that as probably being the key to the success in being able to address some of the issues around delayed discharge. I think your issue about being risk averse is, I think that is an issue. Change is difficult. Doing things differently is always a risk. I think though you can, the evidence that is emerging around what works and works well should help to minimise that. So there are great examples of what has been done that has led to a better service for people and sometimes a more efficient, better service for people. And in the context of increasing demands and ageing population and, you know, resource constraints always being there, it is important that things are done differently. But that does mean sometimes change. The public has a view on some of those changes. I think that it's also about making sure that when change does happen or is proposed, that the benefits of what new services are and are going to be are clear. And, you know, that we've had debates in this place about some of those changes. And, you know, I think it's upon all of us as politicians to, yes, interrogate some proposals for change, but I think also to accept that, you know, we do need to see change. If we carry on as we are, spending money in the same things, then we'll get the same results. And we've got to change because the population is changing, their needs are changing, and the services that we have need to evolve if we're going to not just meet the needs of today but 10, 15 years down the line. That's not going to be easy, and we need to support local leaders in driving forward some of those changes. If you look at the example Jeff raised around the winter beds, there's a risk there, and of course there's always a contingency plan so that, you know, if it does, it doesn't work, then there needs to be a management of that risk. But to not open masses of acute beds in the winter, as has always been done, is doing things differently and carries a degree of risk. However, if it leads to the sustainable avoidance of people going into hospital that don't need to be there, then surely that's a better way of providing services than just opening winter beds, because that's what's always been done.
There's a few things which are beginning to come onto the table around the cultural and behavioural change. So one of the conversations which has emerged in the last 3 or 4 months from the chief officer group is a conversation about acute commissioning. And it's the question about whether in terms of the structure of the unscheduled care service, which is currently provided by hospitals, is that the service that they would want to buy? And part of that's come out of experience where, as they've addressed delayed discharge, what they've seen is that the hospital has still been challenging as an environment, and they've simply seen in some cases additional admissions take up the space created by additional discharges. So they're now having a conversation about how it is that they actually engage in terms of the hospital environment. The group of chief officers, around half of them come from local authority backgrounds, around half of them come from health backgrounds, but in health backgrounds they tend to be more in planning or in community settings. So, you know, this is a group of people who are now becoming engaged with what goes on within the hospital in a new way, and from that are beginning to ask questions about whether they would, if they were setting out the specification for the service, they would specify it differently to work better as part of a integrated system. So we're beginning to see that arise. We're seeing quite a cultural bias towards greater use of data. So people are both tracking activity and financial data in a way in which they hadn't before. They're using the analysis that we've done around the 2% of people using around 50% of the resources. So they're using that that data to better understand where to actually use their resource and the choices that they might make differently. So they're an interesting group. You know, they meet monthly. We meet with them monthly as well. And so they're also engaged in conversations between each other about what they find is working, but also how they're working within the broader environment. So, you know, I'm expecting to see that change process accelerate, as they see more opportunity and as they gain more confidence. But it is quite a quickly transforming space.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Mr. McLaughlin, What was the percentage increase that health and social care received across the piece for this year?
The uplift for this year was 5.5% on average for territorial boards. If that answers your question.
5.5%?
Of an uplift.
That's not what they tell us.
So, I mean, I can give you the breakdown of that. If
that's the case, then, you know, for example, why is NHS Lothian cutting 90 million?
Well, within the... Although the allocations are... as Christine says...
Cabinet Secretary, could I ask Ms McLaughlin first, and then
so,
I'll come
to... Yes, of course.
So just to be factual about it, so £474 million was the value of that uplift to boards. The breakdown within it is there was a real terms uplift, which last year real terms was 1.7%. There was funding for social care, the £250 million, and then it was a combination of other things such as additional... NRAC funding for boards that were below parity and delayed discharges. So that's what made up the total of the uplift.
See, if I speak to NHS Lothian, they tell me that they got 1%.
So what, 1.7% was the real terms uplift NHS
Lothian.
And
they tell me that health inflation is 6%.
So if I can just take you through that. So the uplift was 1.7% for all territorial boards as a minimum for real terms uplift. NHS Lothian then received additional funding for being below parity in their funding. What the board obviously has to do, like all boards, is be able to balance off the inflationary pressures that they have as well, and that's why you see boards on average were about just under 5% efficiency savings this year, which are recycled within their system.
So can we stop there, because you're getting into accountancy speak that I do not understand and do not wish to understand. But so they got 1.7%?
That's correct.
Does that take account of the 6% health inflation?
6% health inflation isn't a figure that I would recognise.
That's what they tell me.
The inflation that boards will talk about will be the combination of pay inflation,
yes,
drugs inflation
across the board.
And so if you look at pay, it's been running about 1% of inflation. Prescribing, I think Lothian would probably be in the 10-12% region in terms of prescribing inflation.
So across the board, they tell me that across the board, it's 6%. That they regard as being health inflation.
Well, I think probably the way I would try to put that in simplest terms, if I can do, would be what's the total level of efficiency savings that boards require to generate in order to break even? Because that should by and large be the figure that you're talking about, albeit it will include things like developments to services as well, and Lothian would have had some of them within
their
plans.
So they have, in effect, a 5% cut to make.
It's not a cut, it's the level to which you need to create efficiencies within your system in order to...
You see, that comes to the next question then, because I've heard this for all my time in either local government or in this place, that efficiency is the word that gets... We've heard it probably 20 times this morning. It then leads me to a question as to why have we been paying some very senior managers lots of money to be running such inefficient services? If that's what's... If you were dropping someone in from Mars just now who hadn't listened to the background of this, they would be saying, hold a minute, these people have been running services for so long. If they're so inefficient, why do we continue to employ them? Now, I don't believe that for one second. But that's the inference in what you're saying.
It's certainly not the inference that I would put on it. Generating efficiencies is a combination of things, and all boards will look at the extent to which services that provided could be provided in the same way but more efficiently, or the extent to which they can do things differently. I don't think for a second that implies that they are being inherently inefficient in the way that they're doing, but they need to continually strive to live within their means. NHS Lothian's efficiency savings target, you say, is around 6% savings, but that is not all about cost inflation in things like pay and drugs. It's also about developments that Lothian are putting in place within their board. So I think I would disagree with the fact, with any implication that boards are being inefficient in what they're doing. So I would agree with your analysis on that.
My final point, are there any cuts being made?
So boards are looking at a number of things this year. So within that overall just under 5% savings, some of the things that they're doing will be savings that they'll make this year.
Are there any cuts being made to services?
So the savings that they'll make this year will sometimes be things that they'll not be able to do on a recurring basis, if I can put it that
is
way.
Is that yes, then?
So it, I guess it depends what you mean by a cut in service.
Are there services being cut, in your opinion?
In my opinion, what boards are looking to do is to provide the best outcomes they can with the funding they've got, and it's
that's
a whole range of services within there.
Are there cuts being made to services?
Well, boards...
I'm asking Mrs. McLaughlin and her experience, because she's the finance person.
So if I can answer it from my experience, what I see boards looking to do is to take an approach to this, which is a way to identify savings to their baseline that don't impact on clinical outcomes. It's not a language that I would typically use with boards, nor is it a language that directors of finance would use.
Well, I know it's not the language would use, and it might not be the language that you would use, but it's the language that the public and the people that we represent move. Many of them will understand what you're saying, but to cut through that, they understand it in those terms, to cuts to services or not cuts to services, and it appears that you can't answer that question.
Try and answer the question, convener. I think the public understand that record levels of funding have gone in to the NHS. I think the public understand, though, that demands increase and continue to increase. Now, we all live within resource constraints. Even you, convener, I'm sure would accept that. And the NHS has actually got the lion's share of Scottish Government resources for a number of years, including this last financial year. Now, within that, though, I have never argued that things are not challenging and boards will require to manage those resources with all of the demands that are being made, whether it's inflation, whether it's pay, whether it's demands on services which continue to grow, which is why we just spent the last hour talking about why things need to change and that services need to change and evolve. If we keep doing the same things and not changing services, then your constituents will not get the best deal for the public money that goes into it. And I would thought that collectively we all have a stake in making sure that money is spent in the most efficient way possible. And I think our managers, although there are 25% less managers under this government, because we believed that it is right that we don't have a top-heavy management structure within the NHS, so there's 25% less managers. Those managers have a very challenging job to do, and Christine and her colleagues work very, very closely with them to try and make sure that every public pound that we put into the NHS gets to the front line, providing the most efficient service, the best service for the people, whether it's of Lothian or any other board area. But of course, you know, that is challenging, which is why we're spending, you know, time talking about integration, why we're talking about examples of providing services in a better way. That's why we're here this morning with this evidence session.
I'm still not sure whether that's saying there are or not, there aren't cuts to services.
Well, there'll be changes to services, convener. I mean, I'm sure you wouldn't expect everything to stay in the same way. Otherwise, if we'd taken that approach and there's not going to be any changes, we wouldn't be sitting here talking about the world of integration and changing services in the way that we are. We want services to be better.
Ivan.
Thanks, convener. Kind of just following up on that, but shifted the focus slightly to talk about outcomes and performance measures. And I suppose just reflecting on that discussion there, I mean, to my mind, efficiency isn't an absolute term, it's very much a relative term. You should always be able to get more efficient, no matter how efficient you are. And reflecting on this kind of cuts versus efficiency debate, again, to my mind, it's all about, if you're talking about efficiency, that's about getting more from less, whereas cuts is getting less from less, in my mind. So I think the direction of efficiency is absolutely where we should go. But clearly, as part of that, defining what the more is important in terms of your outcomes. And I suppose I just want to get your reflection on the performance measures, the outcomes, the indicators we've got in place. Are they up for the job? And I know there's a review coming up. And then following on from that, again, reflecting on some of the discussions we've had with the health board that were in earlier, is there an understanding the importance of being able to link budgets to outcomes and how that process works, because we kind of got the feeling that there was maybe a gap in perception and understanding there. And just before I leave that, just to reflect on one thing that's come up a couple of times, which maybe stresses the importance of that. The letter we wrote to you in the last couple of weeks following on from the delayed discharge review we had, one of the points you raised there was specifically about Glasgow and delayed discharges. And there seems to be a difference in interpretation of the metric, in that some health boards include interim care in their delayed discharge and some don't. And I'm not saying Glasgow aren't doing a good job, but certainly the job they seem to be doing is made a lot better by the fact that they're one of the boards that doesn't include interim care step-down beds in their metric. But coming back to the main thrust of the question around about performance measures and linking that to budgets, where do you see that and how do you see it developing?
Well, what we measure and why we measure things is important, and obviously the review that Harry Burns has taken forward is geared to try and make sure that we measure the right things, which is about outcomes for patients. I mean, we can talk about money into services, we can talk about whether services change, whether we put money into that instead of that. But at the end of the day, the most important thing in all of that is what the outcomes for people are. And the work Harry Burns is doing across both the health system and the care system is to look at whether we can get a better set of measurements that better reflect what those outcomes are. At the moment, we have, and we've dramatically reduced them over the years, but we have a set of targets that a lot of which are quite input focused. So they measure what goes in rather than what comes out and what the outcomes are for people. So did that person end up remaining with a quality of life in their own home for longer because of that intervention? Now, I think we're getting better at that, but the work that Harry Burns is doing will help to make sure that across our whole system, where we get those measurements right. And that the investment, I guess, in the priorities that both the health and care system then prioritises will inevitably shift towards those outcomes. I mean, if we set targets as a government, which we would expect boards to deliver, then of course resources have followed those targets. If those outcomes, if those targets have changed to more outcomes based, then we would expect the integrated authorities to prioritise the resources to those outcomes, which hopefully will help to move shifting the balance of care, will help to shift resources into more preventive spend, into keeping people out of hospital and avoiding hospital admission. So the work that Harry Burns has undertaken is very, very important. I think he's the best person for the job. He understands the system very, very well. And I think we'll be able to get us to a place which is going to stand the test of time as well, and we'll balance the views of the professions, who clearly have a view and will input into it, but also I think it's important to hear the public and the patient view about what's important to them, and he will do all of that through that piece of work.
Maybe just to say a wee bit more about the where we are with the indicators that sit underneath the outcomes. So at the moment we have 23 indicators. Mm-hmm. The first 10 of those are largely evaluative.
Yeah.
So we get those every 2 years from the Scottish Health Survey. We also will generally get them a number of months after the survey is completed. So in terms of the degree to which they can actually be useful to partnerships and reshaping services, they're probably not sufficient. Although the space that they're in, which is around people's experience of the healthcare system, is a key area where we need to understand more. With the second group, which are the more numerical, at the moment our view is there's too much of a focus on the interface between the hospital and community, that there's certainly not enough about the quality and experience of primary and community services, and there's also very little in there about population health. So at the moment the only indicator in that space is premature morbidity. So I think the challenge in this is to better reflect the things that we know matter to people, and I think the Cabinet Secretary is right that Sir Harry Burns will do a good
piece of work in this, but certainly what we're seeing from developments in other systems is an increased focus on items such as isolation and loneliness as being core to people's experience of their health and well-being rather than the health and care system. But also a move from looking particularly at care failures through safety to people's sense of safety, and because that affects the degree to which they'll engage with other things within the community. And this is going to take us into the space of needing new ways of measuring what's going on. Can I respond also to the question?
And it's left, so, and we really have to go on to our next point, but by all means finish your point, yeah.
Well, I was going to go on to the second half of the question, which was the question about the delayed discharge metrics, and I think we have offered an answer on that. I think we probably need to understand why it is that we include community hospital beds within the delay figures, and we don't include care home beds within the figures, in that even within community hospitals, we will only include somebody as a delay if they are ready to go home. So it's not all people within community settings and community hospital settings will be considered to be delayed discharge. The question is whether there is something which is now preventing them. Those people who are in step-down accommodation in Glasgow will be receiving assessment, will be receiving reablement, and the assessment is that that is the appropriate place for them to be. Now, it is open to possibility that they may become delayed in that space, but if they become delayed in that space, then the system as has been built in Glasgow simply doesn't work, and it relies on the continued movement of people through the system. And I think the best evidence of the impact that that's had and that focus has had is the degree to which people are increasingly going home rather than going on to institutional settings. So we're seeing that that's been used as part of the discharge process and isn't simply a separate place for delay. It's a place where something is happening.
Yeah, I mean, is there a relationship between that and the budgets, and is there an understanding there? Because I absolutely agree with everything you've said. It's at the next level. Do chief execs understand and people that are in that space, and is there a mechanism there to line up what they're spending and what they're delivering from it? And I suppose just to flip that the other way around, if you rocked up and said you had £100 million to spend extra money or a specific outcome, they'd be queuing up to tell you exactly how they were going to take that money and deliver an outcome for it. But when you flip it on its head and say, right, the money you're getting at the moment, how is that delivering the outcomes? They suddenly find it very, very difficult to give clarity there.
Just a point.
That was a point. Okay, so anyone else? Okay.
Colin.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning. Can I ask a couple of questions just regarding the social care fund in particular? You won't be surprised to know the living wage. Well, on Friday, I met with Margaret Patterson, who's the Dumfries and Galloway branch rep on the Scottish Care National Committee and also managing director of Stewartry Care, a local care provider. And Margaret obviously described the somewhat fraught process that took place in the run-up to the 1st of October to get agreement between IGBs and social care providers to deliver the living wage, and it's a process that's also been described as by a number of people that have came to this committee. It's obviously clear that IGBs and providers don't want to see a repeat of that process next year, presuming the government obviously continue the commitment to pay the living wage beyond this year. So can I ask what lessons have been learned from the process, and what improvements do you see coming next year? In particular, first of all, how will the living wage actually be funded beyond this year? And secondly, will we actually get, for example, proper costings for the living wage, so we don't have that sort of disconnect that we had this year between what the government's original estimates were and what the reality has turned out to be for social care providers? And I suppose the third point is, will we build on the living wage by guaranteeing that it will be paid to staff that carry out sleepover shifts next year?
First of all, it's a good thing, though, isn't it, that we're on the track to deliver the living wage, and that staff working in the social care sector who previously didn't get the living wage will get the living wage from the 1st of October. And I'm sure that is something collectively that we all support. The process has been difficult. I think by its nature, the fact that what has had to be delivered is a series of local negotiations. That was never going to be easy, and Jeff and his team have very much supported those local partnerships in being able to get to the place they've got to now. And Jeff will be able to give you the latest update on where we have got to. And of course, any providers where there has been a delay, there will of course be back. It will their pay, the individual's pay will be backdated to the 1st of October, so no one will lose out because of any delay on agreement. The issue of sleepovers has been a challenging one, and because of the views of providers, the very people that you've just been talking about, in saying that there needed to be more time in order to ensure that services weren't withdrawn from vulnerable people, which I'm sure nobody around this table would want, and to make sure that the issues that needed to be resolved were resolved, and the unions have indeed supported that position, that there's now a process being put in place to resolve the position of sleepovers. I've been very clear that I want people who are being paid for sleepovers to be paid at the living wage rate, and that's the ambition to get there. But I do understand some of the complexities of that, and that's why we listened to what providers and indeed the unions were saying, and that's why more time has been taken to ensure that we get that right in a way that doesn't undermine and doesn't pull the rug from under vulnerable people getting services. Jeff, do you want to give the latest on where we are?
Yeah, I met with the provider organisations, Scottish Carers, CCPS, the unions and COSLA yesterday, and I've been meeting with them about once every 2 weeks or more frequently, alongside telephone calls and emails over the period since probably the beginning of August. This has been a testing process. Effectively, we have negotiated with 32 local authorities. We've then seen 32 local authorities negotiate with somewhere north of 500 providers, and ultimately the benefit will be felt in changes to around 100,000 employment contracts, and that's not insignificant. That's 2-3% of all the employment contracts in the country. So we've tested the current system to destruction in terms of processes which would normally have gone through cyclically over 3-4 years through councils. We've basically worked through those over a 6-month period. From that, there are a number of elements of learning, and we talked yesterday, and particularly the second half of yesterday's meeting was focused on what does this mean for 17-18, and on the basis of this, what would we do differently? So we're looking at the particular challenges around providers who provide services across a number of authority areas, particularly those likely to be delivering either mental health or learning disability or more high tariff services, and how we can think differently about that in future years, because part of the challenge this year has been having to reach agreements with 23 or 24 different authorities before they can reach an agreement with their staff. We're working through some of the challenges of procurement as well, and again, what we've seen in some areas is that the amount of resource that councils have within their system to take through the procurement has been limited. So we need further work there. We also, I think, are looking at some components in terms of the cost structure of services, in that we've been surprised that while in many cases that the living wage can be delivered at £15 or £16 an hour, in some cases we're being told by providers that they can't deliver it for £20 an hour. And when the wage we're talking about is £8.25, we're looking again to see how it is that we understand why it is more difficult to provide the living wage by some providers than by others, even when there's already differentials in the space. Scottish Care have raised with us the issue of differentials and on costs, and again, we've said that we would look at those. Although, I think, to be fair, in terms of what we're seeing in terms of the resource that have gone in from the £250 million, is it's broadly comparable to what we anticipated that this would cost. So, the figures that we offered through SPICE last year are not that far away from what we're actually seeing in practice. I think the distribution of those figures perhaps has been different in that how those have impacted on different local authority areas has been variable, but also the degree to which partnerships in looking at what it's costing them have also included some of the costs of their staff for in-house services, as well as services which are being provided through the private and voluntary sector. And that's particularly where the additional resource was offered on the basis that councils were already in the place of saying that there were living wage employers coming into 16-17. So it continues. We will meet again 3 to 4 times between now and Christmas with the other stakeholders, and we are putting together an event towards the end of November, beginning of December, to think through and work through the issues of sleepovers, because at the moment what we're seeing is a number of areas where they are offering enhanced wages to sleepovers on the basis of the progress that they felt that they could make within this year, but also looking to see how we can best use sleepovers and the degree to which there are other ways in which we can structure services to give people better outcomes. So,
solutions from the Green Party there. Colin?
A couple of points raised. I mean, I come back to the original question, which was how will the living wage be funded next year? Presuming there'll be a commitment there to pay that living wage, and I'd be keen to know that commitment is there and how it'll be funded. Ms. Higgins, you made the point that the figure, that the government's estimate and the actual reality were pretty similar, but the information we've got back from IGBs is, 20 completed a survey to this committee, and from those 20, the cost of the living wage was about £47.7 million. That was just from 20, but your estimate was £37 million. So I'm not entirely clear how that's close, when actually the actual cost is significantly more than the estimate based on the information we've been given by IGB. So I'll come back to the second part of my question is, will the government calculate and publish very clearly what the estimate by IGB, what the cost will be taken going forward when it comes to the living wage in future years?
Can I answer the first part of the question? That obviously the living wage is a key commitment and one that we want to ensure continues to be delivered. It will be part of the spending review negotiations to make sure that we can do that. Now, we need to obviously look at the real-time information, which is still filtering through around what the actual cost of delivering the living wage is from partnership to partnership. Some have, and there is a significant variation in that. Some were further along the road towards that already, and therefore the cost is different from those where they would have been further away from that in terms of the amount that they were paying providers to provide services. So, of course, we'll look at all of that in taking forward the negotiations to ensure that we continue to deliver the living wage into the future.
And I guess just to come back to the difference, a good example, and when we were looking at the material that you'd sourced from integration authorities, there were a couple that stood out. So Dumfries and Galloway, I think in the figures that they showed you, suggested that they thought the living wage was going to cost them something like £4 million. But that £4 million includes the resource which is associated with their own council staff, as well as the private and voluntary sector services. And as I've said, in terms of the commitment that was made for the use of the new and additional money, the 250, that was focused on the resource which was in that private and voluntary and didn't include the costs. Now, it's entirely legitimate for partnerships to use some of the 250 million also to support additional wage costs within the council, and that's what they've declared to you as they've done, but that didn't fall within the data that we provided through SPICE at an earlier stage. Beyond that, I think there is also the question of the impact of sleepovers within this, which I think going into the process, neither the providers nor ourselves nor COSLA nor the unions forecast to be the issue that it was. And we've had to work through that issue as we're not entirely at the most satisfactory place on that, but we will work through to achieve our objective in that space. So some of it will be accounted for by the sleepover issue.
Yeah. The original estimate of £37 million is the cost of the living wage faced by IGBs.
So So the assessment of the cost within the figures in respect of the services which were covered by the commitment, which are the independent and voluntary sector, including those services which are provided through the National Care Home contract, you know, our sense is, and we've been, you know, looking at this again over the last few days in the context of looking into next year, our assessment is that that's broadly the 6 months' value of the... So it's in that ballpark.
I think, you know, the point Jeff has made is that there were some of the returns included the commitment on that councils were funding for their own staff, so it would have included the uplift for their own staff rather than the commitment to deliver for the independent and voluntary sector. So clearly that wasn't in the figures provided to Spice, because all we provided to Spice was the estimates of the delivery of the living wage for the private and voluntary sector. So I think, you know, we need to, having said that, we will obviously use the real-time information once all of the financial information is available and all the deals have been completed. You know, we will have that real-time information to inform us of where we go from next year, and we're already beginning to have those discussions with local government.
On the living wage, I think, you know, there's no one here would not say that this is very good news. However, we met with 25 social care workers recently to discuss a whole range of workforce issues, and probably the most powerful testimony that I've heard for a long time from witnesses who've spoken to committees. And they raised numerous, in fact I've got a page full of issues here, that they raised in relation to workforce issues about downtime during the day, travelling time, paying for uniforms, paying for phone calls, lack of continuity of care, lack of feeling valued, all of those issues that we're all very, very familiar with in relation to the social care sector. And we'll be writing to the Cabinet Secretary soon about that. But one of the issues that comes across, I think, very clear and has been reinforced by Mr. Huggins' evidence this morning, where he says that they've been involved in 32 negotiations, 500 providers have been involved, and 100,000 staff. In the evidence that we heard before this committee, all of those issues have brought together the providers and the trade unions calling for national collective bargaining. And I think that's hugely significant that both sides are saying that we need national collective bargaining. Is there a commitment from government to move towards national collective bargaining very soon in this sector? Because I think, personally, I think that's the most significant thing that could be done at a governmental level, is move towards that to address all of those workforce issues in a systematic manner that makes social care what it has to be, and that is a sector that people want to join, not that people want to leave.
I have never claimed that only addressing pay is going to, you know, be the panacea for a change of, I guess, how we view and value the care sector. It's going to require more than just addressing pay. Having said that, pay is important, and the principle of the living wage being paid to those who are looking after our most vulnerable, I think, is a good signal that we value the care sector and we want to encourage people to come into the care sector and remain working in the care sector. But the issues you raise that are in and around the sector beyond pay are legitimate issues, absolutely. Career progression is another one, and we are looking at how do we create better career opportunities within the care sector to potentially for people to move into the regulated professions if they so wish, and so on, and to have the opportunity in education and training to do that. So these are all issues that we're very much aware of. It can't just be the responsibility of government to resolve that, though. It has to be in partnership with local government and with the sector itself. Obviously, we do have the National Care Home contract, which delivers a national deal for care homes. Home care at home has been different, and we have had the numerous negotiations. We are now talking to the sector about how we can move forward to perhaps address some of those issues that are common across the sector, and perhaps to avoid some of the difficulties we've had. Jeff, you're closer to some of those discussions.
Yeah, so I suppose since the summer, as I've said, we've met face-to-face five or six times with the unions to discuss where we are on living wage, and they've yet to raise with us the suggestion that they would like national collective bargaining on behalf of staff. So it may be that that's an issue that they're raising elsewhere, but they haven't raised it with us, and I'm not aware that they've...
Could you ask them at their next meeting?
I'm not aware that they've raised it with COSLA either, because, of course, their negotiation would be with local government. It wouldn't be directly with the central government. What we do have, though, is a conversation which is about, in the same way that there is a framework for the provision of residential care through the National Care Home contract, whether there would equally be value in having a framework for care at home and for housing support where that relates to care services, which would, you know, effectively, potentially, maybe for different sectors and across different geographies, set target rates for the hourly rate to be paid to providers, with also the expectations that go around that in respect of things such as terms and conditions. So that's a conversation which we have been having, and I think there are pluses and minuses to it. But it's one that we've certainly indicated to the providers and to other partners that we're happy to continue to have. So I'm not sure whether those two things have maybe become intertwined, but I'm certainly happy to, next time I see the SDUC, ask them what their position is in respect of collective bargaining. So.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thanks very much, everyone, for giving you evidence this morning. And I'll now suspend briefly to allow the panel to change. Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary and your colleagues. Okay, agenda item 4 is a petition that's been referred to us by the Public Petitions Committee and that we previously discussed on the 13th of December. Can I ask members for their views on the petition?
My view on it is that we keep it open and wait for the results of the information that's coming back to us next year.
Of the work ongoing?
Yeah.
Any other views on what we do with the petition? Happy to support Ivan's position. Agreed? Thank you. As agreed earlier, we will now move into private session.